Welcome to Bio 190. My name is Sarah Sweet, and I will be your teacher throughout the semester as we embark on the exciting world of ocean science and marine biology. As you may or may not know, I am one of the educators at the Aquarium of the Pacific right here in Long Beach, and I hope that many of you will get to come to the aquarium later on in the semester when we do have a field trip opportunity. If you're not close to Long Beach, don't worry, you will have many options for that field trip opportunity. You don't necessarily have to come to the aquarium, but there is more to come about those details later on in the semester. Some housekeeping materials before we move on with regard to how the semester is going to work. Blackboard and your new email through Cal State Dominguez Hills are going to be the primary ways that I communicate with you, along with, of course, this program or this class each and every single Tuesday afternoon from 3 to 4:30. It is very, very important that you are on Blackboard and that you check your email on a very regular basis to make sure that you know what is due, what some of the upcoming assignments are, and so on. Some of you are not on Blackboard yet, and we know that. We understand that you will be getting your username and password soon. So if you are not on Blackboard yet, don't worry, it will be coming soon, the information that will get you onto that site. And then once you are on Blackboard Weather, just make yourself familiar with the site. Click around, see where the assignments are going to be, see where the syllabus is. If you are on Blackboard, I know that there are very few items on there yet, or as of right now, rather. The syllabus is up there. If you look under course materials or course information, you will see the syllabus. So that should give you a good sense of what your semester will look like, and items will appear throughout the next week, so do keep yourself very well aware of Blackboard. And again, keep the lines of communication open. If you have any questions for me, I will give you my email. It is sswain@lbaop.org, and that might appear here on the screen in just a minute. So make sure that that you write that down, and feel free to keep the lines of communication open with me. And together we will embark on this journey throughout the semester, and you will learn a whole bunch about the ocean, which is, of course, my primary goal. Without further ado, I do want to introduce you to somebody else who's here with me in the studio. This gentleman whose hand I don't have a third hand, believe it or not. This is David Mader, and Dave has been a really big part of this class in the past. And in fact, we'll maybe be teaching a few of the classes later on in November. So he might be in the seat where I'm sitting right now, interviewing some of the other educators or staff from the aquarium. So this is how our classes are going to work. It is that you will see me each and every single week, but a different person from the aquarium will be coming with me. And this week is Dave. I'm so lucky to have Dave as my first guest. Today is going to be about oceanography. We do have a question coming in, which will happen periodically. Do you know what book we will be needing for this course? And that's coming from Leslie. Leslie, we do know. It is on the syllabus, which again, I just posted this morning, and I apologize for that. And the book is called An Introduction, Marine Biology Coloring Book. I'm so sorry. It's called Marine Biology Coloring Book. And again, the author is escaping me, but it can be found on the syllabus. And I can send out an email when I get back to my computer to make sure you all know. Look on Amazon. That is my best suggestion for where to find it. And again, it's called Marine Biology Coloring Book. And we will be referencing a few other readings from that book throughout the semester. So I encourage you to get it. If you're not able to get it within for the first few weeks of the course, that's okay. But we do need you to have that book eventually. Or share it possibly with us if you can.
It may sound strange, the Marine Biology Coloring Book, for teachers who are watching this and students, is actually a really great just a general overview of all things marine science and oceanography, especially with the content that's going to be covered in this class, being in the Pacific, where you cover, you know, local animals, the animals from the tropics, and this book kind of covers, you know, like it was designed for the Aquarium of the Pacific, so it's a very good abridged text. Especially for this class.
And we even reference it on a very frequent basis. And yes, you have the ability to color, so you can buy some crayons and color it if you want to, but that even in and of itself can be a really neat teaching tool of color this. And of course, do not need to do that aspect of it.
You should offer extra credit for a fully color
yeah, coloring. Yeah, he sends me a rebalancing coloring book that has no coloring out of the lines. Alright, so marine science is what we're getting into, but that means a whole lot more than just the animals. Certainly, I think that when most of us think of the ocean, we think of the animals that live in the ocean, and for a lot of people, that is what is so fascinating about the ocean. But we're going to start today with oceanography. So not necessarily, we might get to them later on, not necessarily the creatures, but we're going to take a step back and look at what those creatures are living in, which of course we obviously know is water. But more than that, what are they dependent on? Not everywhere in the world's oceans is the same. Here is very different than Hawaii. And so what do those animals need to survive, and what's it like for them? So before we get into the animals specifically, let's explore oceanography. So we'll begin by, what is oceanography? Is that different than marine biology, marine science? What does that mean?
Well, what we're going to talk about today, I think you just covered all of this, is really give ourselves a baseline. So we're going to talk a lot about marine life, what's living in the ocean, but before we talk about that, we need to talk about what the ocean is, what's it made of, what are the properties of it, what are the chemical and physical processes that happen there. So the study of oceanography, and maybe marine sciences more generally, is the study of the chemical and physical properties of the ocean. So we're going to talk about the ocean from kind of a very broad perspective. We'll talk about currents. We'll talk about the water itself and the properties that water has. And in general, we have a little bit of biology when we talk about oceanography. We're talking about biological oceanography, but it's very small things. It's usually how they interact with the environment around them. So there's biological oceanography, chemical oceanography, physical oceanography, and geological oceanography, but all having to do with kind of major processes, major earth processes, and the major part of our planet, which is all that water.
Yeah. Right. So I think if you take a look at the tail ending of oceanography, initially it started as just the mapping of the ocean, of where things are, how deep is it here, are there mountains under there, but it's morphed into so much more, as Dave was mentioning, that it's the physical boundaries, the chemical components that we know that there's gold, the trace amounts of gold in seawater, there's calcium, and there's so much that kind of need to explore biologically. Obviously, it's the living organisms, and then geology, the geology of the volcanoes and the rocks that are under there, and really quite fascinating. In terms of the idea or the jobs that are associated with marine biology, marine biology does tend to be more of the organisms or the live organisms that there are a lot of us study. But oceanography certainly is an area of study for many, many people. Scripps Institute of Oceanography. So while we don't necessarily when we think of the ocean, of these components, they are very, very important.
There's a lot of overlap. It's not like oceanography is only study water or anything like that, or marine biologists never study the chemical and physical processes of the ocean. Oftentimes, those things are really important for the things that they're swimming through and living in them. So, Scripps, for instance, doesn't focus on really tiny things and major oceanic processes, but also on living things, on whales, and all sorts of other stuff. So, a lot of crossover in the marine biology, so oceanography is one of those things.
Okay. So without further ado, because I do tend to skip this, and while I'm thinking of it, I do want to introduce the concept of our mystery item, because each and every single week we are going to have a mystery item sitting right here on the desk with us. And so this is the moment you go get a nice bird's eye view of the mystery item there from above. So what we do with this mystery item is pretty much this. We show you a picture of it, and we encourage you to guess what it is, an educated guess, please. And the person that guesses correctly first is going to get an extra credit point. Throughout the semester, you will get several extra credit opportunities, and this is one that will happen each and every single week. This is one of the strong benefits to watching the class live. I know that there are many of you that are not able to do that and watch it through the archive a little bit later, but if you are able to watch it live, you can type into us your guess as to what this is. And again, the first person to get it correct does get an extra credit point. So, Dave, let's imagine diving down to the bottom of the ocean. So we hit the bottom, which doesn't necessarily mean it's a specific depth, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But go even further, that when we're on land, I think we have a good idea of, we think of ourselves as a circle. We go back to fourth grade, what's under there? And there are processes under the bottom of the ocean that are dictating what happens.
Sure, and then it's good to think of the earth and the ocean all as a unit, but outside of unit, what we look like today is how it always looked like. The continents weren't always where they were. The oceans weren't always where they were either. The Pacific Ocean is the largest ocean. It's also the oldest ocean on the planet. But the Atlantic Ocean is younger. It's spanning, it's spreading. We're talking about earthly tides. And when we talk about those things, we're really talking about how the earth is layered. We have an inner kind of solid layer, a liquid layer on the outside of that, that these continental plates are floating on. And oceanic plates, which are made of a different material than our continental plates are light, they float a little bit higher than the oceanic plates. The oceanic plates are just sucked up below those things. If we're looking for really old rock on the planet, we're always looking at continental plates because those are up on the surface. Oceanic plate gets gobbled up down below. And I guess the oldest oceanic plate we can find is about 300 million years old, which is not that old in terms of the planet being 4.5 billion years old. And it's all because of the processes we see here, the inner core, outer core mantle, and then this little bit of crust that we live on the outside. It's the interactions of that mantle and crust that really provide a dynamic earth, one that's moving and shaping, and it shapes life processes, it shapes what's happening in the ocean. All of these things are affected by the positioning of the continental plates, the crust, all that kind of stuff.
I think one of the best ways to think about that is a tsunami, and I think certainly those we're most familiar with the tsunami that was in 2004. It was just devastating. Under all that water are these plates, and whether they move back and forth or they come together and kind of go up, movement of these plates is what dictates a lot of the processes in the ocean. And in that specific case, it displaced, and we'll talk more about this semester, but all the water above the moving plates had to go somewhere to form this tsunami. And so what you see there in the background is an image of the plates to give you a sense of how all the plates are connected. So if you take a look at Africa, and I'm going to use this cool new tool I have over here, you can see Africa right over here, but this big thing, this is the big plate that is surrounding it. So that gives you a sense of not all the plates, the tectonic plates under each continent are the perfect shape of the continent. And those plates rubbing against each other or coming together is what can form some of these volcanoes and tsunamis and earthquakes and so on.
Behind us, if you look, the Pacific plate right here, this big piece right here in the middle. And anything that's on or in that Pacific plate is more or less going to move as one unit as it floats about the ocean. So we see Hawaii right in the middle. We have hot spots sometimes in the middle. But we can actually see the movements of these continental plates by looking at the chain of islands surrounding that. So if you want to really nerd out later, look at an oceanic map, and you can see that all of the little island chains, they all follow straight line paths up until a certain point, and then they take a nice turn up and to the right to show that sometime in geological history, the plate actually did shift directions and move from one area to another. And eventually, all of those islands get gobbled up by one French on the other side. So, on the leading edge of these, we have continental crust, oceanic crust being created, and then also being on the far end by oceanic fringes, places where the oceanic plates are going down into the mantle and being remelted.
Right. We'll talk about the mantle coming out actually later on in the semester. Okay, we do have some guests. We have Marissa with a clam shell. We have Chloe with a shell. Dana, was the shell a spiny jewel box? And Leslie Arsenella, which I have to say I don't know what that is because it sounds like a science to me. Dana, let's see, the top one was pretty darn close, so we will go with Marissa as being closest. Marissa, I need a little bit more detail, though. You are down the right path there, but a little bit more detail for me as to specifics. Oh, you do? Okay, let's move down. Okay. Corey has it. It is. Okay. Corey is the species right, though?
Corey, you make comment.
Corey, you're pretty darn close. I don't know that the species is right, so Corey is pretty close as well. Moving on, as we have more guests coming in with Marissa and Corey being close, so let's talk about the ocean. So I often encourage people to take a look at a globe. You know, we call our big globe Mother Earth, right? But it may be more commonly known or better known, maybe I want to rename it as Mother Water. Because if you look, there's so much more blue, and we do have a lot more water on Earth than we do land. So give us a sense, what does a lot more mean? How much water is there?
We have lots of different oceans. 71-70% of the ocean surface is covered in water. And about 97% of all of the water on our planet is seawater. So it just kind of puts that in perspective. Most of the planet is ocean, most of the planet is salt water, and most of the living space on our planet is contained ocean. Let's also put that in perspective for how much of it we actually know. We've probably studied about 3-5% of the sea floor. You know, the 5% being around Monterey Bay, where there's 28 different oceanographic institutes actually studying the ocean right there. We only know about 5% of the bottom right there, right next to the coast. Most of the living space then is between the bottom and the surface. So we're looking at about 97% of our planet being completely unexplored, where we know next to nothing about what's actually going on there. We know all kinds of things about lions and tigers and elephants. We're still learning things about them every day. And we have this largely unexplored expanse just right outside. It's so important and vital for life on the planet. Probably contains most of the life on the planet in biomass. That probably does contain most of life in biomass on our planet. And we consider it job security. There's so much left to be known. But again, it's so alien, so not what we typically think of when we think about living things. We might think about fish, but the massive expanse of the Pacific Ocean and what might be living in the middle, 1,000 feet down in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Nobody knows what's really going on there or can tell me exactly what processes are affecting it. And so it's really incredible to think about this, especially in terms of everything we need to know about the ocean today, especially with all the changes that are happening.
And there is, within our industry, a common saying that we know more about the moon than we do know about the ocean, and that is very, very true. In fact, there was just an article yesterday that they have, for the first time, found some reefs off of near Hawaii, I should say, that they are seeing for the very, very first time. It is a giant clam, Corey. I don't know about a flinted giant clam specifically, but it is close enough. So Corey M. is going to receive our first extra credit point of the semester. And that is how it's done, my friends. Each and every week there will be a mystery animal, and I will, I think it's safe to say that it will get harder from today. We'll try. I might have some easy ones, but hopefully we'll try and stump you, because Corey got it pretty darn quickly. Congratulations.
That's really quick. I think you probably wanted also to talk about, we have Pacific Ocean, Indian Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Southern Ocean. We have all of the major oceans and the Arctic Ocean above. But clearly looking at this map, they're not separate entities. They're obviously connected by lots of different places. There really is just one world ocean that's completely interconnected. There are actually currents that actually travel between oceans. So energy is exchanged between these oceans. Water is exchanged between these oceans. So there really is one continuous body of water on the planet. But we are the aquarium Pacific. We obviously do label things, and that's kind of what we see below. Some of you may not be familiar with Southern Ocean. It's kind of an addition. It's a new ocean recently discovered in the south, believe it or not. They were looking for it in the north, but they discovered it in the south. So anyways, Southern Ocean is surrounds Antarctica and actually has its own properties. It has its own water currents that travel all the way around the continent of Antarctica. So it's somewhat separate, but it can be a Southern Ocean arbitrarily defined down there just as much as we arbitrarily define all the other oceans.
Yeah, I think what's interesting about it is it doesn't have specific boundaries. If you look at the Pacific Ocean on that map, again, they're all connected, but you can kind of see where the Pacific Ocean lies. I think it's really important to know the Pacific Ocean, of course, just here off of our coast, is the largest. In fact, if you combine the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, the volume of water or the size would fit into the Pacific Ocean. So it is a huge body of water. Perhaps you've heard the word sea before. I'm sure you have, such as the Mediterranean Sea. Mediterranean Sea versus the ocean. What's the difference between an ocean and a sea? Well, seas tend to be a little, or not a little, but often very much confined. So they are confined by land. I think it's on at least, I don't know for what percentage it is, but if you think of the Mediterranean Ocean, it essentially only has that one opening out into the Atlantic. Now, some seas have more than that one opening to another body of water, but that gives you a sense of the difference between an ocean and the sea.
Sick on the sea.
I don't know about you, I can see how the ocean too. If you mentioned earlier, what does the bottom mean? And if you go off the coast, if you're an elephant seal and you eat stingrays, you are going to always find your stingray at 30 feet, maybe it's at 60 feet. So I want to give everybody, Dave, a sense of what is deep, what do we define as deep ocean, and have we, to our knowledge, found the deepest part in the ocean so far?
I think to our knowledge, we've found the deepest part of the ocean is the Challenger deep in the Marianas Trench, which would be right around, I can never do this, right around there. I'm getting close. Yeah, okay, anyways. Yeah, somewhere around there. Is the Marianas Trench, the Challenger deep in the Marianas Trench, about 35,000 feet deep. Average depth of the ocean is not that deep, however, it's around 11,600 feet, or about 2.2 miles. Which is still significant depth. So we're talking most of the ocean being thousands and thousands and thousands of feet deep. And same diving limits is 120 feet for normal scuba diving. And then add on a rebreather and maybe some nitrox, you get down to 200 or so feet. And that's where you can explore as far as scuba diving goes, as a submersible, and you can get a lot further, but there are only one or two submersibles on the planet that can get down to the deepest parts. There was only one submersible to get down to the bottom of the Marianas Trench, that was manned. That was the Trieste, and it was back in the 50s or 60s, something like that. Two guys did go to the bottom of the deepest part of our planet and looked out the window and saw fish. It was just incredible to think about. Talking about the deepest part of the ocean, 35,000 feet deep, just incredible. Depth right there. You can fit Mount Everest down into that that trench and still have water on top of it. They got all the way down to the bottom and looked out and saw fish. Now, prior to going there, they thought it's so harsh, the conditions are down there, that they would only see, at the most, maybe they would see some vertebrate life. They that higher life forms couldn't be sustained out of those depths. And they saw flounder. So they actually saw a fairly high-level vertebrate swim away from their boat. Now, also thinking that maybe it's a pea that they dropped down into the ocean, looked out the window, and saw a fish. It gives you an example of what there is to see, how much life there is, even in these really extreme environments down the bottom. It's absolutely chocked full of living things that we don't know anything about.
And I think it's important to know one of the main reasons you mentioned that we can only go to 80 and 250 feet at the most, even if we have the rebreather, which of course is a way that scuba divers can stay down even longer. But the primary reason that you as a human and the oceanographers have trouble exploring these deep depths is the same thing you feel in your ears when you dive to 10 feet down the ocean or in a swimming pool, and that's pressure. So we're going to jump ahead just a little bit here, but the pressure at these depths is immense. It is something that we are not able to deal with as humans because we have a lot of gas space in our bodies. A lot of animals, such as the sea jelly, for example, 90%+ water, they don't have a lot of gas-filled spaces. So gas is much more compressible than water is. And so animals that have a lot of water in their body can sustain some of these pressures. So here on land, we have one atmosphere of pressure. And so for every 32 feet you go down, it increases. And so maybe you felt that pressure before as you dive down. Another problem is temperature. It is not pleasant down there in these depths. It's very, very chilly. And temperature is something that we want to explore with oceans in general, not just in the deep depths, but the temperatures here in Southern California are very much different than we'll take Hawaii, for example, and that dictates what life can live there. But the ocean as a whole is very good at regulating not only their temperature, but our temperature as well, right? That what we feel on a daily basis is very much controlled by the ocean.
Absolutely, and you talk about all of these things. The ocean is really what helps to sustain life on the planet, to give us our weather, and all these things. Right here off Southern California, we have such a mild climate. It has everything to do with the ocean right off our coast. If you look at the same latitudes on the east coast of the United States, you're not talking, you know, around the Georgias, the Carolinas, and we're talking 90% humidity, really, really high temperatures, and it's all dictated by their ocean currents that are off the coast around there. So we have the warm Gulf Stream coming up from warm Caribbean waters, and it's heating up, bringing all that moisture and hot air with it. So you get the humidity and the storms, all of that's translated by the water that's there. Off our coast, we're getting a cold water current down from the north, and that's going to make our climate a lot milder. It's going to keep us cooler and drier, not as wet. But the ocean itself and its circulation patterns are really transferring energy around the planet. If it weren't for the ocean's heat that hit the middle of our planet, it'd stay there. And there would be very little heat to be transferred up to other latitudes. We talk about places like England and Europe, where Western civilization kind of helped develop the Mediterranean. A lot of this climate that was up there was made habitable by the warm Gulf Stream, bringing warm water up to those latitudes and making that really arable land places that a civilization could grow. Take away ocean circulation patterns, and a lot of that heat transfer, energy transfer, it just doesn't exist. The weather patterns that we see just don't exist.
And you may be hearing some, or you will later, about this topic specifically with regard to global climate change as well. That it's very much become an issue with regard to how important the oceans are in absorbing our heat and making our climate tolerable. And that is something that could very much be changing, or is changing, rather, right now.
Let's talk really quickly. It's probably of water that gives it this capacity. It's called the heat capacity. And water generally has a tendency to resist change in temperature. It takes a lot of heat to actually get water to or a lot of energy to get water any heat to actually get it to absorb that energy. But once it has that energy, it doesn't release it very quickly. Very slowly over time dissipates that energy, so it's a great thing to kind of transfer energy all over the planet. We talk about rocks and things like that. They heat up very quickly, but they also dissipate their heat very quickly. You know, we talk about like a hot, the cement is very hot on a hot summer day. As soon as the sun goes down, the cement is now cool. Water is not the same way. The ocean temperature is the same temperature at nighttime as it was during the day. The heat of that day has very little effect on what temperature the ocean is. It is really much, all that energy is really happening down at the equator. It's getting heated over time, generally gradually, and then releasing that energy generally and gradually out into our planet. That's because of the heat capacity of water.
Yeah, you don't have 50-degree ocean water during the summer and then a big change in the winter, opposite, I suppose, but it doesn't change very quickly. Okay, so just taking a step backwards and regrouping as to where we are. So we're talking about properties of water. We talked about the immense pressure, and that's certainly something that a lot of ocean life has to deal with, and what depth can they sustain, how far can they dive. But as Dave mentioned, is that such an issue? Flounder are able to supposedly go to 35,000 feet, and so that's something that isn't as easily explained. I think a lot of times the ocean animals are surprising us, that I would not have thought, but maybe everyone else knew that a flounder could sustain life at 35,000 feet. We're also looking at temperature. That temperature also dictates what happens in the ocean, where animals live, why sea otters are so hairy, and they're the only animal without blubber. And again, we'll continue to talk to them about these things throughout the semester. Well, another one that's really fascinating is density. That the easiest way to describe that is if I walked over here and tried to pick Dave up in the air right now, I might be able to, but probably not. However, if Dave and I went in the swimming pool together, I could probably pick him up really easy and feel like Arnold Schwarzenegger. That has nothing to do with Dave having losing weight between the air of the swimming pool, but it's because of density. Can you explain that a little bit more?
Well, water is about 800 times more dense than air, so what happens when you get into water is there's a buoyant force. There's actually, the water exerts a force back up on your body, so it's actually helping you out. When you get into the swimming pool, you can pick me up a lot easier because of that buoyant force. Owing a lot to do with the density of water, the properties of water itself. So we think about what lives in water and how does the density and the buoyant force translate into what things look like once they get into the water. You can get animals that can be extremely huge out in the oceans, like blue whales. The largest animal that's ever lived on the planet, as far as we know, exists today. It's the blue whale at 300,000 pounds. That immense animal couldn't exist on land without having really immense structures to support it. So there were some dinosaurs that were very, very big, and they had very, very big bones and a whole lot of resource that went into creating those. Talking about blue whales, their bones are actually fairly thin compared to their mass. So you can get really massive animals because of that buoyant force existing out in this environment that's helping support their bodies. You can also get extremely fragile animals existing out in the ocean, like sea jellies and things like that, because they can just float about in the ocean without really exerting a whole lot of energy. They don't have to have a lot of robust parts of their body. There's not really something that exists like a sea jelly on land, because on land you have a lot of gravity and a lot of other forces that are going to contribute to it falling apart from that fragile.
So I think the best way to think of it is on a molecular level, that all the water molecules are really tightly compact, right, making them more dense, so they're able to support us a little bit more, whereas in air, not as compact, not as dense, and so we are able to move much more freely, and that's even more obvious in a swimming pool. When you try and move, you feel like you're in slow motion, and that's again because of the tightly compact molecules, and so they're supporting that weight. They're supporting the weight of the blue whale, and supporting the weight of Dave, and it makes it feel like it's a lot easier. Another way to think about this is light. That if you went outside right now, you could see the light of the sun very, very easily. But if you go down to the bottom of the ocean, which is much closer than the sunshine is, you can see an ounce of that light, that it just can't penetrate that really dense ocean water. Again, 800 times more dense than air. And so that really dictates, again, what can live there. You're never going to see a blue whale walking around on land. Now, that's also because it has no legs, and it does a few other reasons. But density is really what allows such a massive animal to live in the ocean. So density, pressure, and temperature, definitely some elements of the ocean that the animals have to deal with. But along with that is the type of water. So Dave mentioned earlier that 71% of our land is covered in water. But if you break that down, if you had all the water in a ball, much of it, and most of it, 97%, is salt water, whereas only 3% is fresh water. And even within that, we'll talk more about conservation later. I know I keep saying that, but we have so much to talk about this semester. 3%, 1% is for me and you and all the other billions of people on the planet. But that 97% is the salt water. And a measure of salt water is what?
Salinity. Okay. I think is what you get at. Yeah. And obviously salt water that we're talking about mostly. out there in the ocean, that's mostly that's what it's made of. And it has a varying amount of salinity depending where you are on the planet. Seawater varies between 33 and 35 parts per thousand. Parts per thousand, it's really parts per parts. It's a unitless measure, but we like to have units to think. So 33 to 35 ppt in some places on the planet are a lot saltier. So if we think about our planet, anywhere we have a lot of evaporation, which would take water out, but not the minerals that would allow cause salinity. And when we talk about salinity, you should say it's not just sodium and chloride. Table salt is what that would be, but it's all sorts of other minerals that are dissolved in there. The main constituents in seawater are sodium and chloride, but after that, potassium, magnesium, all sorts of things, additional gold, pretty much anything that's a polar molecule can be dissolved in dissolved in water is going to be found as a constituent within seawater, with major components being calcium, magnesium, potassium, sodium, chloride. Basically, what our rocks are made out of, the large parts, any dissolvable parts of rocks, will be found out there in the ocean. And when evaporation happens, all of those things get concentrated. So you can imagine the first ocean that ever existed on the planet wouldn't have been very salty. It's been getting slowly salty, more and more salty over time. It's very massive. It doesn't change very quickly. But in those places on our planet that you have lots of evaporation and not a lot of precipitation, so not a lot of freshwater input, you have higher salinities. The Red Sea is a good example of one of these places. Very high salinity, and actually very buoyancy. So you go in the Red Sea, you're floating.
You got even better.
Even better. Hard to believe. And then you go to other places on the planet, salt marshes and things like that. We have a high freshwater input. We might even call that brackish water. So hypo and hyper for saline environments, but anything that's got a little bit of a salt in it, generally think of it as a marine environment. Even one that's very low in salinity, those salt marshes still considered a marine environment, and those hyper saline environments also.
Although there are some places that are so salty that animals can't live there, the Dead Sea, for example, gets its name for a reason. There are very few organisms that can withstand the amount of salt that is in the Dead Sea. So remembering that the average seawater, if you went out to the Pacific right now, you measured it, you would get 35 parts per million, which of course means that if you measured fresh water, it would have 0 parts per million. And then there is water, depending on where you go, that's kind of anywhere between. And again, Dave mentioned that that's called brackish water, but it goes over 35 too, and that's what you're mentioning about the Red Sea, the Dead Sea. And unfortunately, the human population is creating areas that are unnaturally dead seas, and that's due to overproductivity of plankton, and I think that we will get there in a little while. But we're creating our very own dead zones in certain areas, which is different. It's not because of the salt, but we will talk about that because it's very important. So when we think of the ocean, we often think of the beach, and with the beach comes that sand. And it's important to know what Dave just mentioned of why the ocean is salty. That may seem like a kind of a silly question, but it's not at all, and it's one that we get quite often in the aquarium, and it's due to erosion, and that's exactly what Dave just mentioned. So a lot of those same minerals or components of seawater are the very same ones that are in the rocks upstream in our mountains, and as they erode, they're washing down our watershed through our waterways, rivers, and so on, and into the ocean, and making it a little bit saltier. So who knows? It's hard to say by 500,000 years what the salinity, the average salinity of the ocean will be.
Yeah, it's interesting. It was nothing that was ever discussed about the classes in marine biology classes. It's a great point. There may be some sort of sink that I'm not thinking of for minerals, someplace where minerals like sodium chloride will get consumed and taken out of the water. So that we have a relatively stable salinity out there in the ocean, because it's relatively stable right now. We can measure an increase or decrease through input. We can through evaporation, export of water, but not so much through import of mineral into the water. But you would think that somehow it's being maintained, but there's nothing ever discussed.
It's the monster.
It's the salt mineral monster out there.
Okay, so one more thing before we move on to the beach and the waves is that what we were seeing earlier, what I'm looking at down here, for your guess is for the mystery item, but this tool can be used for your question, which, perfect, we just had one come through. If there is anything that is not clear, anything that you have questions about, anything that just plain does not make sense, please email us or use your chat board as you were doing there to guess your mystery item. That is going to be our source of communication because this is a very unique classroom in the sense that you are not directly in front of me. This is the way that I need you to communicate with me. So don't let it just kind of slide. I have no idea what she's talking about, and let us move on. Probably you don't know what Dave's talking about, but you're still welcome to go ahead and give us those questions. So the ocean will just continuously get more and more salty over time. That's a really good question. From data in recent history, the answer is no, because we've not necessarily seen that happen as far as we have data that goes back, which compared to how old the Earth is really not very long. Our data is just a small snippet of time. So again, that's what Dave was mentioning of, you would think that, yes. But maybe something does happen in the breakdown process that kind of maintains it at this specific level, the amount of salt in the ocean that does not allow it to increase. But those are questions that, to my knowledge, in terms of oceanographers, are still being explored.
Yeah, and like I said, it was nothing we discussed in the class. It's one of those questions that just kind of comes up where it's a great question. So they may have an answer, they have a very simple answer. It's just one of those things, there's so much to learn and so much to know out there that you know, we want to look at the blue whales, and it's hard to get interested in how much sodium chloride is all around that
time.
I agree, they just don't write books.
Yeah.
I it's a great question. How about if anybody can tell us the answer to it? Maybe it does exist out there. Why isn't the ocean continuously getting more and more salty? Everything that I've known, you know, I can think of all the imports for dissolved mineral into the ocean, but not a whole lot of export of those dissolved minerals other than maybe calcium, magnesium, some of the things that would be caught up in the bodies of organisms in the water, the biological action of the water. But sodium chloride, I mean, it does get taken up in the bodies, but not significant, I would think.
All right, so when we think of the beach, we think of waves, but there is so much more than that. Right here, you'll see a picture of what we call rough seas, and then this is what many of us don't like when we're out on a boat. But the wind is generating what we see there, and I think that's what we don't realize is that the wind generates the not only what you see on the screen, but the waves are crashing on the beach. Now, the difference between that is a few other common terms that we want to clarify for you. A wave is different than a current. A current is different than a tide, and then all of those are different than a tsunami. So, David, if you'll just quickly tell us about the different kinds of waves, so let's start there.
Well, we can talk about a couple of things real quick. Maybe we'll go through the process of you're stuck at sea, and you're out there, you have no sail, you're hoping to get somewhere, you see some waves coming. They're not going to help you out. You're not going to go anywhere. Waves transfer energy from one place to another. When you're floating out at sea, you're just part of the water, and that energy is going to move right past you. The water actually doesn't move when we're talking about a wave. Only energy transfers in a wave. That's actually the definition of a wave. And so when we look at the sea, we see all of those waves. We see the swells behind us, or the rough seas behind us. This is the beginning formation of those organized swells that would come and break on our shores. Wind is what generates those waves. Eventually, they organize themselves a little bit more. And this is the energy, not the actual water being organized in any sort of fashion, but really the energy of that wind being more now, more organized as it comes towards the shore. Now, energy is not, is for the most part, not being lost. So waves can travel, where am I looking right now? Waves can travel thousands of miles across the ocean. And you really still have the same amount of energy as when they first got that energy from a swell, that blowing wind, as they go through the seas. You go from rough seas to swells, and then actually crashing waves. You saw the logo crashing on the shore. And if you think about here in Southern California, it takes about a week for a storm off New Zealand to translate the energy of that wave from that storm to our coast. You can think about it this way. When we're talking, I think that Sarah can't smell my breath, because my breath is not coming across, the wind of my voice is not coming across to her ears, but actually the vibrations of my vocal cords, the energy is translating from my voice to her ears, just as a wave from the wind in New Zealand, the energy translates across, not the water.
And I think the place that you've probably seen this is in a stadium, in a football stadium, a baseball stadium, you name it, that someone starts the energy of the wave by going like this. And then the person over here starts or has the energy now and does it again. So I did not get up and move and do it here and then there all the way around the football stadium. But rather it's that transfer of energy, and that's exactly what's happening in these water molecules. So essentially they're transferring that energy to the water molecule next to them, and on it goes. But that water molecule, it didn't get up and move over there. It's still exactly where it is. It kind of went up and down and stays where it is. So again, it's that transfer of energy. The wind is going to move your sailboat, but if you lost at sea, the wind is. But the waves, or the water specifically, is not going to move that sailboat.
Right, but water does move from one place to another, just not in the form of a wave.
Right.
If it does move from one place to another, what we're talking about is a current. Now, just to confuse things, most surface currents that might move your boat are actually driven by wind. So they kind of get the ball rolling and then the water keeps moving. But a current will actually move your boat from one place to another. We can see the major surface currents all over our planet. Looking at the northern hemisphere, clockwise currents that we see.
So, Dave, I'm going to just reference what you talked about earlier here, is that cold water obviously coming down from Alaska right there, right? Right across us here in California, which makes our climate a little bit more mild, right? Whereas here you can see warm water coming up against Florida, making them a little bit more warm. Okay, so that's what you were mentioning earlier.
And even all the way up into, you know, New York first date, we're really talking about very, very mild, much more mild, hotter, warmer, more humid summers up in upstate New York than you would find in the same latitude up in Oregon, Washington. It's freezing in Monterey in the summertime. It has to do with the water. We're talking about major surface currents. There's lots of little currents that happen within this major ocean circulation patterns, but these are major ocean circulation patterns, and actually through U.S. history, we're going to learn about the trade winds and following these major currents and these major winds to move in this current over here on the East Coast. We have the same type of current off of our coast, bringing warm water from the equator up through Japan, cooling off when it gets up into the Bering Sea, and then bringing that cold water back down. It travels in a clockwise and counterclockwise current. These are mainly due to Coriolis forces that, we'll talk about Coriolis maybe on another day's class on that, but that's what causes these things. A really cool current right here at the bottom. I think it's cool. This circumpolar current down here on the Southern Ocean is amazing because this little gap that starts going right through between South America and Antarctica pinches the water of that current. And if we think about it, there's a constant, almost 4-knot current from top to bottom running through this. Doesn't sound very fast, 4 knots, it's just roughly 4 miles an hour. But we talk about the mass and volume of water. We can take every river in the world and all of the volume of water that flows down every river on the entire planet, and that's how much water is moving through that point. So massive movements of water and energy, all the energy from the sun in this part of our planet. These are our surface currents. And just, you can ride one of these currents for a long way. So there's a guy who lost his mast mid-channel between Catalina and the mainland, and he ended up in Costa Rica, not being blown anywhere, floating on a current from here to Costa Rica. So have a radio with you.
Yeah, didn't, obviously.
No radio, didn't tell anybody where he's going.
Yeah,
obviously, it may be very quiet. He didn't yell at anybody who's passing up. Eight seals drink rain water and made it to Costa Rica.
All right, Lucy, erosion of rocks definitely is how salt and minerals get to the ocean, but I think our bigger question was, is there any research out there that's indicating that it is not going to become saltier and saltier for whatever reason? What is that reason of, do scientists and researchers know of the calcium and the salt, rather, not the calcium, the salt being used up enough where the levels will kind of stay the same? Judy, don't the amounts of salt in the ocean depend on melting glaciers, and when the sea dissipates, some of the salt are blown onto the land?
I would say the latter part, so the salt's being blown onto land, could be exactly the answer that we're looking for, but I would imagine any salt blown on the land would very quickly, rainwater would hit on the salt and flow back. Whether it would become a sediment later and really trapped on land, I'm not sure that would happen. As far as the glaciers melting into the seas, absolutely a melting landlocked glacier would contribute to a lot of fresh water on the planet, but it also is going to have a lot of mineral salt in that, or coming back with it down into the sea. Whether or not there's enough fresh water locked in, say, Greenland and Antarctica to make the ocean less saline when they melt, probably will become a little less saline. I don't know what that's going to translate to. Obviously, we've got significant volumes of water, but whether or not it's enough to really alter the salinity of the oceans, I don't know. But then we'd be saying we're in a period of very high salinity right now. We're in a kind of mini ice age right now with our polar caps, and as all those things melt, is happening. We may see lower salinities in the ocean. This is a question I think we'll look up. We'll see if we can find the answer to that back at the aquarium and get back to you guys.
Okay, so Dave, do you want to take a break? Are you okay?
We can keep going. We'll take a break.
I don't think we'll take a break because we'll just keep
on going. Yeah.
Tides are very different than currents. Currents are kind of they're a little bit harder to understand, which with regard to how they're driven. So, where does this start? Where does it all start? Oftentimes they're a little bit easier to talk about because they actually have nothing to do with what's on our planet Earth, but so much more that with regards to what's in our galaxy, stars and the moons and our sun, and some of them specifically, have a very big effect on our Earth. Tell us about that.
And
our times, rather. Yeah, I think that's why I say galaxy.
The sun and the moon have a strong effect on the tides. The tides are generally a wave. If you look at a tide graph, you'll see a wave pattern on that tide graph. What we're talking about is gravitational forces of the sun and the moon. The liquid ocean being easy to kind of pull and drag and bend will be pulled out towards a large gravitational body like the moon, like the sun. The moon being much more responsible for the height of the tide, and then the sun also contributing. And then what's kind of, if you haven't actually thought about it, which causes the high and low tides on our planet is the Earth spinning underneath this bulge of water caused by the gravitational force of the moon pulling on the water. So as the Earth spins underneath the moon, you would have high and low tide.
So these are what they're dictating here is the bulges. You can see those coming out. And then, as we're spinning.
Yeah, so at the top of this picture, if you were standing there on the top of the planet in that picture, you'd be at low tide. And then you would spin, and as you were underneath that bulge, you would be at high tide. And you'd be coming in and out of high tide as the Earth rotated underneath those large gravitational forces. Now, the sun and moon both contribute to high and low tides. If they're working together, as in this picture right here, we call it spring tide. We have very high tides and very low tides. Everything's working together to pull on the water on the planet. If they're working against each other at 90 degrees to each other, then we have what's called a neap tide, where the high tides are not so high, the low tides are not so low. Here's an example of a neap tide. The sun and the moon working against each other. The cool thing is that you know it's going to be a spring or a neap tide by looking at the phases of the moon, because obviously you can see in this picture that the phase of the moon is going to be affected by the orientation it has to the sun and the Earth. So at, say, a quarter moon, we're going to have a neap tide. At a full or a new moon, we're going to have a spring tide. And that's something cool. And Corey M. has a good answer. Maybe subduction to remove some of the minerals and salts from the ocean, which would be absolutely true if there was a way to mineralize and dissolve, reconstitute the dissolved minerals in the seawater. So if there was a way of getting sodium and chloride, putting them together, making the solid, dropping them to the bottom, making them a sediment, and then subducting that sediment, you'd get rid of some of that salt water. But I don't know the mechanism for all of that. That's what we have to figure out.
So here in California, how are the tides affecting us? If you've ever been to a tide pool, hopefully you looked at the tide chart, which we'll see a picture of here in the background before you went, because if you go at high tide, you're probably not going to be seeing very many creatures in the little pools because they're covered by water. And so each area on the planet, area near the ocean, you can see there in the background, the very confusing convoluted chart, but that is essentially what a tide chart looks like. You can learn to read one of those, or you can look at the internet and look at what high and low tide are. But each area around the world does have a different tide. So our tides here in Southern California are not the same tides as in Ireland, for example, because as you can imagine, as we're spinning, we have the different latitudes, so we're affected very much, very differently by that gravitational pull of the moon and the sun. And we have some pictures here in the background of some extreme tides. I think Bay of Fundy is certainly known as the area that has the most extreme tides on Earth, to my knowledge. And you can see there, as you can imagine, that would be a high tide in the Bay of Fundy. Clearly, there's plenty of water. Animals can live there, boats can float, whereas here, the tide has gone out totally.
Yeah, and as soon as you make a really simple model for how tides should work, like gravitational pull, the sun, the moon, we didn't even mention, hey, there seems to be another bulge of water on the opposite side of the moon. what's going on with that? So you add in there something called a centrifugal force, the spinning of the Earth and the Moon together. The Moon is not really truly rotating around the Earth, but they're both kind of rotating around a common center, kind of wobbling around each other. You're also talking about all of the bodies, all of the bays, all of the geological structures that are on our planet. All of these are going to affect the movement of water in and out of a certain location. So wherever you go on the planet, your tides are not so simple. All of a sudden, they're very, very complex. We have semi-big, semi-diurnal tides off our coast, meaning we have a high and a low high tide, and a high low and a low low tide off our coast. The other coasts have just semi-diurnal, just two highs, two lows, sort of equal. Other places have one high and one low.
It's called diurnal.
And then some places don't really seem to have low tides at all. It's a matter of inches. Tahiti, we were hanging out in Tahiti, inches for the tides on the beach there. Whereas we go to Fiji, still out there in the South Pacific, and you have many feet of high and low tide. All has to do with the geological structures around its position on the planet. All of those kinds of things add complexity. And as soon as you look up and try to find the answer for what causes the tides, you'll see that scientists are really still figuring it all out. Again, more job security for us. We've got the basics down for what causes the tides, but it's something as basic as the tides has a lot of complexity into it, and it's still a lot to be learned.
One good example, and certainly areas where a lot of water is rushing in and then a lot of water has somewhere to go, Sea of Cortez has amazing tides. I spent some time down there, the water, it looks like it's just gone, kind of like here in the background of the Bay of Fundy. So it's really neat to see that as you travel and the differences around the world. What we're going to get into now is starting to move towards some of the animals that we'll maybe get some time to talk about as we wrap up the last half hour of class here. But we do want to mention the productivity, which is the base of all food chains in the ocean and many food chains on land. If any of you enjoy eating fish sticks or oysters or anything that's come from the ocean, productivity and essentially photosynthesis is what helps get that food chain, that food web going to help you enjoy that that food. And so what you see in the background is essentially, we'll go back to that graphic for just a minute, of productivity. And so what does productivity mean, or the nutrient cycles?
Sure. We're transitioning into here is a little bit of biological
oceanography. Right.
We're talking still about dissolved minerals that are out there in the ocean. But the minerals we're going to be talking about now are nutrient minerals, minerals that organisms use to help them sustain life. We're talking about mostly nitrogen, phosphorus, all of these other things, but also those ones that we would put on our plants if we wanted to grow crops or if we wanted to grow and fertilize a plant. We're talking about mostly fertilizers. When we talk about that, we're mostly talking about nitrogenous compounds, nitrogen, ammonia, nitrates, all things that are dissolved into the ocean as well and have lots of inputs into the ocean through mostly animal waste, but also a few other ways that nitrogens can get into the water, nitrogen fixing, sorts of things like that. We look at false color images of the planet, like this cool one behind us. We're looking at not a uniform amount of photosynthesis on the entire planet. What causes this difference in the amount of productivity on the planet, or the amount of photosynthesis on the planet? Keep mentioning this word productivity. Productivity is the amount and rate of photosynthesis. What we're looking here is we see lots of green and red being those areas that have very high productivity, lots of photosynthesis happening in the water, and then the light blues, the dark blues, being areas of very low productivity. Why do we see this disparity? This has mostly to do with nutrients. These are places on the planet that have access to the ocean bottom, that have lots and lots of sunlight that's also needed for photosynthesis. So you add lots of sunlight, we have lots of nutrient in the water. These are all shallow coastal areas that have lots and lots of sunlight. That would lead to lots and lots and lots of plant growth. Not really plant growth, but algae growth. Out there in the ocean, there's not a whole lot of true plant life, but things that are a lot very plant-like, lots of algae. We talk about photosynthesis on the planet. You can take one breath, thank the rainforest, and take a second breath, or maybe second or third breaths, and thank the ocean. most of the oxygen on our planet, or at least half, comes from the ocean. It's these photosynthetic life in the planet, photosynthetic algae out there on the ocean, mostly at the poles along the coast, that are creating lots and lots of photosynthesis and lots of base of the food chain nutrients.
And so what that means is that the more of these organisms there are, the more a fish can eat those and start again that food web. So we see in a lot of areas of high productivity, obviously, that starts this domino effect begins the food chain, as I mentioned earlier. So a lot of times, unfortunately, and I think, Judy, this is a great question that you have, why don't we have red tides frequently here in Southern California? We are, quote-unquote, messing with the productivity a lot of times by increasing the amount of nutrients. So Dave mentioned that productivity and photosynthesis kind of go hand in hand. They have a very strong relationship because productivity is the amount of photosynthesis. And photosynthesis, thinking again back to fourth grade, is the amount of water, sunlight, nutrients. And so if everything comes together, then we have photosynthesis. But by allowing too many nutrients to come down our watersheds, we are, in fact, increasing the productivity by allowing too many of these organisms, specifically phytoplankton or the plant kind of plankton, to kind of bloom and, quote-unquote, explode. But when they all explode together, they all die together, and they form this blanket of death, so to speak, that floats down to the bottom of the ocean, and the decomposers who use oxygen to go through their decomposition process are taking up all that oxygen, and that's where we go back to that area we talked about earlier of creating a dead zone. The oxygen is being used up by all the decomposers who are eating up all that phytoplankton, and so that essentially is that red tide. So we don't have as many red tides as Sea Florida does, but we have, as far as any marine scientist is concerned, too many red tides. And unfortunately, it is linked, most of them, and this isn't a totally 100% well understood process, but most of them are linked back to letting those phosphates, those nutrients, come down our watershed. And again, the phytoplankton just, they produce, they kind of go nuts. There's too many of them.
So we kind of have a mixture of terms as well that commonly used. We have red tides, which are sometimes associated with the red colored algae. So lots of algae have different colors, red being one of those. The water turns red. We sometimes associate those red tides with bioluminescent organisms. We also associate them with algae poisoning. Some of those red algae create a poison or shellfish poisonings. The shellfish eat these algae and concentrate those poisons. People eat the shellfish and then can get sick. We associate that with red tide. Now, other times, red tides don't necessarily produce harmful poisons into the water, but what they do is what Sarah mentioned, which is eutrophication. They bloom, they accumulate in the amount of life that's in the water, and then absorb all the nutrients available, and then in mass all die. Decomposition of all of this now living stuff uses up the oxygen in the water, which then starves and suffocates fish and vertebrates. Also sometimes associated with red blooming algae, but not always red colored algae. The poisons that get introduced into the water through these algae are not always red in color either. So another term that we use today are harmful algal blooms. It's kind of all encompassing for an algae that blooms maybe out of control to cause harm. But red tides still exist as kind of that general term for all things. So red tides are harmful algal blooms. Just know that a red tide isn't always red and doesn't always have poison associated with it. So lots of other ways that a red tide can harm.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so let's look at productivity in various areas throughout the world. And I think we've done that a little bit here with our map in the background of showing you that the productivity isn't the same everywhere you go in the world's oceans. For example, a marsh, so you'll see a picture of a marsh here in the background, tends to be a pretty productive environment. In fact, a very productive environment. We'll spend some time talking about marshes, also called wetlands, a mud flat. All of those are kind of synonymous words, but they're very productive environments. Whereas a coral reef, you'll see here in the background, is beautiful, lots of colors, lots of animals, not a productive environment at all. So why is that?
So we're looking at these two environments. We look at a coastal wetland or a marsh area, and that has a lot of access to sunlight, we had a question. I never knew the amount of sunshine affected the fish. Sunshine is going to be kind of the energy that drives the fish in the food chain.
Right.
No sunlight, no photosynthesis. No life. We can talk about that.
Yeah.
And then we talk about an environment like the coral reef. This is an area that has lots and lots of sunshine, but not a lot of access to nutrient. So that's the other kind of element that you need to grow, to spike productivity. You need to have sunshine, and you need to have nutrients available for the algae to be able to photosynthesize. Within the coral reef, though, in this tropical environment, the productivity is relatively high for the water that they're in. Right outside of the reef is extremely low productivity. Right on the reef is relatively high in productivity. Comparatively, not anywhere near the productivity you would see on, say, like a salt marsh or a coastal environment. But still, relatively high because the association of the algae with the corals, a very tight recycling of nutrients. And that's what allows this productivity to happen, is this very tight recycling of nutrients within the coral reef environment, owing to the association that these corals have with a very particular type of algae. If you look at salt marsh, we have also very tight recycling of nutrients. Things are inputs usually from coastal areas, leaf litter, all that kind of stuff has nutrients to that environment. It's trapped there. It stays there as decomposition happens. You have lots of nutrient available, and you have shallow, warm water. So salt marshes can be among the most productive places on the planet, rivaling the tropical rainforest in the amount of productivity, the rate of photosynthesis that happens there. Baby fish, all kinds of baby animals, birds and things flock to these environments because of that high productivity. And then we talk about tropical seeds. We get away from the coast, we get away from the inputs of nutrients that would come off the land, the animal waste, the decomposition of leaf litter, that sort of stuff that would add a nutrient input. Out into the middle of the ocean, not anywhere near the bottom, a shallow coastal environment at the bottom, all the animal fish waste is going to fall to the bottom and then be recycled back up. We don't have that tight recycling of nutrients. Anything that goes to the bottom there, it's going to drop right out of the water, hit the bottom, and never come back up again. We don't have all of those nutrient inputs, so very low nutrient environment. We call these the oligotrophic areas. There's just nothing growing, there's nothing there. Absolutely nothing, actually. Fairly significant amounts of photosynthesis does happen, but we're talking about very extremely tightly recycled environments. You drop a little bit of ammonia in there and it would disappear instantaneously because the organism is having such a high affinity for nutrient because it's not there in that environment. We're also talking about some of the most crystal clear waters that you would ever find anywhere on the planet. Hundreds of feet of visibility out there because there's nothing between your eyes and wherever you're looking. Our environments over here, there's algae, there's lots of things living and growing between your eyes and anywhere, so very, very low visibility.
Well, and I think that's one thing that if ever you get the opportunity to go dive in a coral reef or a snorkel, hopefully you will think to yourself how clear it is, and then you can see really well, and you can see 70 feet down, and that is a very rare day in a very productive environment, and that's what Dave is mentioning, that there's a lot of, with that productivity comes those phytoplankton, and we're going to talk about those guys in just a minute. What exactly does that mean, a phytoplankton? But they're very, very, very small, essentially kinds of algae. So remembering that algae, we'll talk about that in just a minute, is kind of the marine side of plants. They're not plants, it's important to know that, but when you think of a plant, it's kind of the plants in the ocean, but they are very different than plants. So let's take a step back. And we've been talking about productivity and photosynthesis being the base of food chains, productivity driving what lives where, along with a lot of the components we talked about earlier, temperature and salinity and so on. Animals that need a lot of plankton, if they can't get it, like in a coral reef, have another way of eating, and that's the algae that Dave was mentioning earlier that lives in their body. So what lives where is dictated a lot by that photosynthesis and the productivity, and plankton is the base of that. So before we get too far away from productivity, what is plankton?
Sure, and let's talk about one more thing. When we talk about tropical reef environments, I think people are familiar with a very high diversity of fishes. And so we would think about tropical reef fishing as the environment is having a lot of fish. While they have a lot of fish species, the total biomass of living things within a tropical environment is relatively low compared to other places on the planet. We look right off our coast, the diversity of fishes, the number of species of fish may not be diversity is low. In the aquaculture environment, the diversity is high. There are a lot of types of fish without having a lot of fish there. But you can see them all. This is underwater. So you asked, what are those phytoplankton? What are
those phytoplankton? What's the definition of
plankton? So plankton are drifting organisms. You can give the word plankton to anything that is alive. But the drifting, as Sarah showed us right there, and cannot swim against the current. That's the thing. If there's a current, that planktonic organism is going to go wherever that current goes. If you're a jelly and your current has to drive you onto the beach, you're going to the beach. If you're a planktonic organism, so you don't have to be small. A lot of people want to say planktonic organisms are microscopic organisms out there in the ocean. They're not microscopic necessarily. They're just a lot of water, but they just can't swim against the current. Sea colonies can be huge, and they're planktonic organisms. So there you go. That's what plankton is.
There's a lion's mane jelly, a species of them, in the Antarctic. I think its bell, so the big bulbous part on the top of the sea jelly, is like 9 feet across, and its tentacles are over 100 feet long. That guy is considered plankton because they can pulse up and down. But if he wants to go from here to there, first of all, they can't say that they don't have a brain, but they can. They're going wherever the current takes it. So most of them, again, are small, like the copepod you see there on the image behind us. One of the neat things, first of all, is you might associate this animal you see in the background with plankton on SpongeBob SquarePants. But a pretty neat teaching tool that show for us. And the plankton in the ocean are not mean, like SpongeBob SquarePants liked it. But again, it is a good teaching tool. So the unique thing about this copepod is that he's going to stay like that his whole life. And that's quite different from other plankton.
Most things in the ocean start off their life as plankton, from the largest tuna and billfishes that we have on the planet to the smallest fishes. They just grab crustaceans, anything. It really starts its life drifting about as plankton. Out there in the water, very few animals actually start off their life just right attached to the bottom and not drifting around. We call those animals that only spend part of their life in the plankton as a meroplankton. They're only spending part of their life there. This guy here is holoplankton. He is constantly going to be plankton throughout his life.
His whole life.
We mentioned that you can see the jelly pulse, you can see a jelly move, you can see a copepod move. But moving is a very different thing from swimming. Swimming is moving with purpose from one place to another. These guys can move with purpose from one place to another, but not against the current. Some jellies and some plankton can actually position themselves in a water column so they can ride various currents out to sea, back into shore, and out to sea. And they can do this. They can actually ride currents and position themselves within a body of water, but they're not swimming against the current.
Right.
Like our friend the turtle over here. Yeah. This guy can move against currents, he can move across oceans, and he can go back and forth, and he doesn't have to, dictate. The current doesn't really dictate where this animal's going to go. He can swim against it. We call him nekton. If you knew there was a word that was the opposite of plankton, it's nekton. I say plankton because I love Sir David Attenborough.
Sorry. Do you realize he's plankton? Yes, Right, I believe. Whales do eat plankton, absolutely. Very good call on that one. So krill, the blue whales, specifically, maybe what you're thinking of, but there are many whales that eat plankton. Blue whales eat krill that are no more than about an inch, maybe an inch and a half, and they essentially eat them by being a gigantic filter. So you can think of them as a big tea strainer almost, or a big filter in their mouth, squirt through this giant school, or what is it called, krill? School krill, a clump of krill, we'll call it, and all the krill gets stuck in there, baiting. We'll talk more about that later on, but absolutely. So what I'm getting at here, and what you're mentioning maybe, is that the biggest animal on the planet does eat some of the smallest animals on the planet. That's even true of whale sharks. So whale sharks are the biggest shark on the planet. They have no teeth, by the way, and they also eat plankton against some of the smallest creatures on the planet, but not all plankton are really, really small.
Right, and not all whales actually eat plankton.
No, there are some. So there are some like the blue whale and like the whale shark, but of course not all.
But, all the toothed whales, and some very large whales, and sperm whales actually do not eat plankton.
No. The next word that we have is benthic animals. So we have we've explored plankton, we've explored nekton, and this is a sea cucumber, and the reason that he's considered a benthic animal, or benthos, is that he lives on the bottom. So bottom-dwelling animals are called benthic animals. So again, as Dave mentioned, this sea cucumber did start its life as a plankton floating around in the water column, actually called a pleus, I think their names are. And then at some point, decided to settle down to the bottom and essentially morphed into or changed into the large organism that you see there in the background. Really interesting animals, the sea cucumbers.
They changed into this thing.
Yeah, right. And it decided to look like that, believe it or not. Okay, so let's get into a few more producers, that phytoplankton, or again, the plant plankton, and let's make sure that you know that there are two kinds of plankton, that they are all the drifters and wanderers of the sea, but there are the zooplankton. So just think of the zoo, when you go to the zoo, you're going to see the animals, the zooplankton, and then there's the phytoplankton. So photosynthesis, phytoplankton being, of course, the algae kind of plankton. But they're not the only producers in the ocean. Of course, there are algaes specifically. And there are different kinds of algaes, and they're classified by their colors. So we'll show you here a picture of green algae, and I think this is the one that we can relate to most easily, because when we think of plants or producers, we think of green, our grasses, our shrubs, our bushes, our trees, and so on. But just because an algae in the ocean is not green doesn't mean that it's not photosynthesizing and it's not a producer. In fact, there are a lot of algae in the ocean that are not green, and we'll see a few of those here.
And a good thing to kind of think about when we think about it, I think you mentioned this earlier, that light has trouble penetrating the ocean. The chemical properties, the chemical bonds of the seawater actually absorb sunlight, and they don't let a lot of the visible light actually penetrate down into the water. You get about 30 feet deep and you lose the color red into the ocean, and then down further you lose red bushes. When you get to the deep part, you start to get a little bit more penetration from those. There are less penetration from the indigo and violet. Where am I going with this? Visible light is absorbed at different wavelengths as it goes down. And visible light is the type of light that's used in photosynthesis primarily. Green light doesn't penetrate all that far down into the ocean. Red light doesn't penetrate all that far. And blue light penetrates the furthest. So, plant-like organisms, photosynthetic organisms, have to have a variety of different ways of absorbing different wavelengths of light. Green plants are great at absorbing red light to use in photosynthesis. Red light doesn't penetrate very far, so if you're going to be a photosynthesizing algae, you better have other ways of absorbing sunlight, and that's where we get these other colors, these other pigments of algae in there. We get green algae, brown algae are another algae that's out there that we're familiar with, our giant kelps or brown algae, colored kind of brown in color. And then we also see red algae, so red-colored algae. The color we see, again, remember this is going to be the reflected light from that particular plant or plant-like organism. So it'll be utilizing and absorbing other wavelengths of light. But that's why we see a variety of different colors of algae out there in the ocean. And that's because of the various accessory pigments that they have for absorbing different wavelengths of light.
So not all of them have chlorophyll?
They all have chlorophyll, but they have accessory pigments along with the chlorophyll to help them absorb different wavelengths of light. So whereas certain kinds of chlorophyll might be really great at absorbing certain wavelengths of light, they have accessory pigments that allow them to absorb other wavelengths of light and use that in photosynthetic process. Actually, and as the leaves turn yellow in the fall, when looking at some of those accessory pigments that we can also find within plants on land that disappear as the chlorophyll is drawn back or the nutrients. I don't know, I'm a marine biologist, what do I know about fall colors? But
Corey, does benthic only refer to a marine habitat, or can it be used as freshwater as well? It can be used in as an aquatic term, so certainly to my knowledge, Dave might disagree, but to my knowledge, a river, an estuary, any sort of aquatic habitat, I think the word benthic expands across all of those for sure.
You're a limnologist if you study freshwater habitats. That's the opposite of marine biologist. Marine biologist, limnologist.
Limnologist. Brown algae, I think we do have a picture here just to give you guys an idea. That is kelp. It's giant kelp. When we were talking about very productive habitats, we may have mentioned the kelp forests that are right here off the coast of Southern California. And there, unfortunately, it's washed up in a big heap. But when it is in the water, it's quite beautiful. And as the name denotes, it looks like a giant forest under the water. And we will definitely explore that a bit more. The next picture you'll see here is of eelgrass. And so there are very few plants. As you and I use the word plants in the ocean, but this is actually not considered an algae, but considered one of the very few kinds of plants. One of the things that is very not very well understood, rather, is how this organism deals with salt. To my knowledge, I think we talk about it each and every single year, and we never come up with the answer. So that could be another extra credit of how does eelgrass cope with its salt. And by that I mean if you go to the ocean and get yourself a cup of water, come back to your house and pour it in, and your plant is going to die.
That's your neighbor's
plant. Yeah, and your average vascular plant is not going to cope with salt water at all, but this organism does somehow.
Yeah, it's one of those funny things. We all we ask this every year. We actually look it up every year.
I think we do.
And every year we can't find the answer. So if you can help us out, this is an aquatic marine. It's a marine plant. Lives fully in salt water, and most true plants have some sort of mechanism to help them deal with excess salts. The other type of marine plants we talk about, core grasses, salt grasses, they have a way of exuding excess salts. Mangroves have a way of exuding excess salts in their bodies. Obviously, these live in salt water, maybe they exude excess salts as well. We just have never seen it written anywhere.
Right.
But these seagrasses can actually be fairly important communities off of shallow coastal areas, especially off of Australia, off our coast as well. They're often nursery grounds for juvenile fishes. And this is one of those heavily, heavily impacted environments. Our seagrass beds of our shallow coastal environments are one of those places that's disappearing off of our planet, and they're very important, very beautiful animals that live within these environments. And this can be fairly productive for the planet as well.
And unfortunately, that's a shared characteristic with that word that Dave just mentioned, which is a mangrove. It's maybe something that you're not terribly familiar with because we don't have any of them in Southern California. In fact, around the world, they're becoming a very rare and endangered species. They are within the United States mangroves in Florida, and essentially what it is a kind of tree that can live in salt water. So it's roots, big roots, and that you can actually see are sitting right there in the salt water. So a very unique kind of tree. But again, unfortunately, we are cutting them down at an alarming rate because they are great places to have shrimp farms. And that's a whole other class.
We just talk about a lot of different kinds of algae. So we're talking about productivity in the ocean. We're talking about algae primarily. Very few examples of fruit plants, fruit flowering plants that live, or non-flowering plants that live in saltwater or marine environments. The vast majority of productive things being algae out there in the ocean. Mostly unicellular as well.
Right. We did talk about the phytoplankton and the zooplankton a little bit, but I do want to show you a few pictures here to give you a sense of what on earth would a phytoplankton, again, a plant-like plankton or algae plankton essentially, look like. And you'll see here that it might not be what you expect. The picture we're going to start here is a diatom and then another organism called a dinoflagellate. And Dave will quickly tell you what you're looking at as we move on to see zooplankton.
As of course, these animals, diatomaceous earth, and the skeletons of these animals, and they are have shells of glass, or biogenic opal, that's what I like to call it. Very, very cool. And then our next slide is going to be the dinoflagellate, kind of the second most common type of algae that we find out there in the ocean. Also very cool, kind of spaceship-looking organism we see. And this is a plant-like organism that actually swims. Has a flagella that helps it move within a water column. One along the girdle, the middle part, you see that little part that looks like it's wearing a belt. And then it'll have another tail that kind of sticks out and helps it forward. So they move kind of in a twisting forward motion. These guys can be made of cellulose, so they can have not a very thick shell at all. Very, very diverse group of organisms right here.
And the dinoflagellates are often the ones that are producing the points that we talked about earlier when we were mentioning the red tides. Is this
okay? But most frequently off our coast, at least in recent years, it's been actually a diatom responsible for most of the animal poisons, most of these birds and covering mammals, not caused by an open flagellator, but by a diatom. So we talk about dog acid poisoning or shellfish poisoning off our coast, Tunisia, something caused by a diatom, not a flagellator.
Copepod is the next one, and again, we talked about that one as being plankton its whole life. Those two very characteristic antenna. A lot of plankton have a very spread out body, meaning they have a lot of appendages, legs, arms. They look like legs and arms. They're not that, of course, but very spread out, and that helps them stay near the surface. The next one you'll see is krill. We mentioned krill when we had that question earlier. This is what blue whales eat, and important to know, of course, that not all whales do eat plankton. Many eat something very different. And the next one's that Pluteus, and this is a baby sea star, a baby sea urchin, or a baby sea cucumber. So that obviously looks nothing like any of the three animals that I mentioned, but again, later in life, settles to the bottom and becomes those creatures. We have just a few more minutes. We definitely don't have long enough to get into the world of the animals that are in the ocean, but we can start at the simplest organism for sure. Not simplest organism, simplest animal in terms of invertebrates, or animals that have no backbone, and that is a sponge. And here he comes, our famous SpongeBob. And again, we use this as a teaching tool. I don't know where he is. He's big and yellow. You know what he looks like. There he is. Yes, he does. But there are actual sponges in the ocean. So we'll just give you a picture of one here. Really simple organisms. Very cool. They can get to be many feet tall. 10, I think even 15 feet tall. And very simple in that they don't have tissue. They don't have brains. They don't have muscles. They don't have bones or organs. So very simple animals. And we'll move up just a little bit. Dave, we can talk about these guys really quickly as also being very simple, and that's the sea jelly and their cousin, the sea anemone.
And these guys that we're seeing here at Angola, you're seeing 12 plankton that we've shown you, all the different diversity and why the sea jellies is that the environment that these animals live in, the thing that you're going to experience in the course of this class is the ocean is cool. It's full of a diversity of life and an amazing variety of different kinds of animals, from whales, which we're all familiar with, to these guys behind us, which we're not. It's what keeps us, Kim, coming back and wanting to learn more and why we're interested in this topic. Hopefully you guys are going to be just as interested as we are, because we're going to have a good time. We'll have a good time with you guys.
All right, guys, looks like we just have a few more minutes, so we say goodbye. Keep the lines of communication open. Always email me if you have any questions or concerns. I'll see you here next week, 3 o'clock, and we'll talk about fishes. Thanks so much, guys. Have a good week. I'm sorry.